Now go back to what Jesus said that I quoted earlier when he said, take my yoke upon you, and he said, and learn of me. Learn of me. Jesus will teach you, if you will listen, how to get victory over the sins in your life. It isn't because you just pull up your belt, I'm going to do it today, you know. No, Jesus will guide you. And you know how he may do it? You wake up in the morning, and as you're stumbling out of bed and you're going down to get the coffee, the Lord says, make the bed first. How's making the bed going to keep me sober on Friday night? Make the bed first. Are you going to listen to the Lord or not? Are you going to be guided by his Spirit? Are you going to let him direct your path? Are you going to say, my will be done? You see? The Lord says to you guys, clean up the dishes. Don't make your wife have to do that tonight. You do it. How's that going to keep me from watching the porn on Saturday night on the computer? Do it. Walk in the Spirit, and you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. You see, it takes an absolute surrender of yourself. The interesting thing about being crucified, no one can do it to himself. You can't commit suicide by crucifixion. It's impossible. You can't nail yourself to a cross, can you? It's an absolute surrender. You open up those hands and spread out those arms and say, Lord, you do it. And I will be crucified with Christ. And nevertheless, I will live. But now it's not a legal relationship. Now the life I live is by faith in the Son of God. I'm dead to the law. I'm alive to God. And that's where the victory is found. Now this is the last we're going to see of Peter. We're only halfway through the book of Acts, basically, and Peter's going to disappear for the rest of the book. Interesting that his final portrayal is again validating this door that God has opened to the Gentiles. So now Paul and Barnabas chime in. Verse 12, then all the multitude kept silent and listened to Barnabas and Paul declaring how many miracles and wonders God had worked through them among the Gentiles. In other words, again, guys, God's at work. And they're not getting circumcised. They're not going under the law. But yet the signs, the wonders, the miracles, the proof is clear. And so James, who is the leader of the Jerusalem church, he steps up and he begins with prophecy, showing the word of God validating what has been taking place. Verse 13. And after they had become silent, James answered, saying, men and brethren, listen to me. Simon, that's Peter, has declared how God at the first visited the Gentiles to take out of them a people for his name. And with this, the words of the prophets agree. Just as it is written, after this I will return and will rebuild the tabernacle of David, which has fallen down. I will rebuild its ruins and I will set it up, so that the rest of mankind may seek the Lord, even all the Gentiles who are called by my name, says the Lord who does all these things. Known to God from eternity are all his works. Now he says, thus saith the prophets, plural, but he only quotes one, and that's Amos, but there are many more that could be quoted. Don't be hung up on trying to find every little detail in this prophecy, how it relates to the church. It's a big picture thing. Paul, for example, in Romans chapter 15, kind of like a machine gun blast, rattles off, I think, four verses in a row from various parts of the Old Testament, all showing how it is God's plan to include the Gentiles. And that's the issue here. Again, known to God from eternity are all his works, always been his plan, so that all people can come and receive the blessing from Abraham. And you remember, Abraham was told that all the nations would be blessed through him. Now keep your place here, please, and turn to Deuteronomy 14, if you can, quickly. Deuteronomy 14. I want you to actually read this verse with your own eyes, highlighted, if you so desire. Deuteronomy chapter 14. And we are going to look at verse 2. This is Moses speaking, of course, to the nation of Israel. And what he says in chapter 14, verse 2, for you are a holy people to the Lord your God, and the Lord has chosen you to be a people for himself, a special treasure above all the peoples who are on the face of the earth. Now go back to Acts. So clearly what? you, Israel, a chosen people. God has chosen you above all the other nations. You are special. Now, back to Acts 15, what James said right before the prophecy. Notice, in verse 14, God the first visited the Gentiles to take out of them a people for his name. Folks, if you wonder what this whole church age is all about, and you want to summarize it in one New Testament verse, there's probably no better verse than that one right there. What is going on? What is God doing in these days? He is visiting the Gentiles to take out of them a people for his name. That's what's taking place. Do you see a difference? Has something changed from the era of the law till now? Oh, you bet. Something has radically changed. So now we have Jesus telling us to go in all the world, preach the gospel to every nation, every creature. Be my witnesses, not just here in Jerusalem, but Judea, Samaria, the uttermost parts of the earth. It's open to everybody. It's all free to all who would come. Gentiles don't have to become Jews anymore in Christ. Now, that does not mean that God is done with the nation of Israel. He is not done with the Jewish people. That is the mistake of church history. Oh, God's done with the Jews. No, Paul emphasizes this point throughout Romans chapters 9, 10, and 11, especially chapter 11. He makes it clear. He says, there, first of all, there is still a remnant of Jews who are believers in Jesus Christ, a remnant according to grace. And we recognize that. There are Jews, my wife being one of them, who are Christians today. Now, that is certainly the exception, though not the rule. Most Jews are not believers in Jesus Christ. And Paul explains, a blindness in part, because some Jews get saved, but a blindness has happened. What we call a judicial blindness, because again, it's from God, because of the rejection of Jesus, yes. But it's only for a time. He says, blindness in part has happened until what? The fullness of the Gentiles comes in. That's the rapture of the church. And then God will once more deal with Israel directly as the church, where there is no Jew or Gentile distinction, is raptured out. And yet the rapture is described as the fullness of the Gentiles. Fits right here with what we're reading in verse 14. If we are to rightly divide the word of truth, as the scripture commands us, we need to understand this teaching. And what I am talking about here are the different dispensations in the Bible. Oh, people freak out when they hear that word. In fact, you can spend your whole life in Calvary Chapel circles. You can listen to K-Wave 24/7. And I'm dead serious. You will rarely, if ever, hear the word dispensations, dispensationalism. It's just not taught. Even though Calvary Chapels are dispensational churches. We believe in a distinction between the church and Israel, absolutely. We believe God's still going to work with Israel. We believe the rapture is going to happen before the tribulation. We believe Jesus is going to return to set up the millennium kingdom. We believe in literally interpreting the scripture. And yet we shy away from this teaching, and it's to our error that we do. This is one reason why this was one of my book recommendations right out of the gate. Not to try to sell books, but we have in the bookstore an excellent book that will explain this if this is all brand new to you. It shouldn't be. Dispensation is a word in the Bible. It's in Ephesians, a couple places.